When Boy Meets Girl.
When Boy Meets Girl. Hi. Welcome.
Hi, everyone.
Welcome, welcome. Today's the day. Today's the day that we are celebrating our union. Today is the day that we are celebrating this mystical, magical, and spiritual thing that has happened between us. And we thought that it would be a good time for us to share our story with you, for those of you who don't know. I realized that you were the one for me, Ren, when I literally could not get you off my mind. I thought about you all the time. I was concerned about all your needs, and it became obvious to me that you were so much more than a friend, more than I had ever expected, more than I ever thought that I would want. And I actually thought that you could only truly fall in love once in your life, and you proved me wrong, because as I found myself falling in love with you, I realized that I had been opened up to something brand new, that God was setting me on a new journey. And I'm so thankful that my journey is with you. You know, you are everything to me. I love you so much.
I guess I can say that I realized when I was really falling in love with you, I had fallen in love with you, was when I literally could talk to you all night and fall asleep and wake up the next morning with the phone actually in my hand, and never hung up from that night or that evening. And you would say, "You fell asleep on me." I was like, "No, I didn't." But the evidence of me falling asleep was in my hand. Drive to work with you in my ear, and actually talk to you all day on my Bluetooth. And I would hear you with your clients, and you would hear me with whatever I was doing for that day. And we would actually talk 24 hours a day.
I know, really. It was
really wild. And not only that, I would go out to eat. I would go home and shower. I said, "Well, you know, I got to pick somewhere to eat." And you said, "Well, why don't you go to this place or that place?" And I would actually go. I would set, sort of like set my phone up where I could actually, you could like video, you could actually see me and I could see you. And I would actually driving down the road, and actually, you know, you would see exactly where I was going. I would go, whether it was Kickback Jack's or you know, whatever restaurant I decided to go to, and I would actually prop my phone where you could actually see me eating dinner, and you would recommend salmon, or you know, you was just helping up. So you would recommend salmon for a lot of evenings that I would go out to eat. So those are some of the reasons, and some of the knowing and the promptings that I knew that you was the one for me. Told them, "I will get married, but I will get married to the right person." You know, the whole time, it wasn't about being married, it's about being married to the right person. And I think if you hold out long enough and wait on God and be patient, as I was and as I am at this very moment, you would be the happiest man alive. And she would be the happiest woman alive.
Because I am the happiest woman alive.
I'm 58 years old. And for 58 years I dated. It wasn't until this woman came along. And so I obeyed the Lord. I almost lost her. I did some stupid things while I was dating. Because, you know, many times we men can we can say one thing but end up doing something else.
Okay, so the reason why we decided to have a sit down and do it is because every week we are on Facebook and we have a session where we get together with all of our friends and family and we call it date night. And how it started was one evening we were getting ready to go out on our normal weekly date night. And so Ren said, well, you know what, instead of going out on our normal date night, let's go live. And somebody just asked us, they were like, you know, we really love your relationship and we wish you guys would talk about it. And I was a very private person where Ren was a social butterfly.
Oh, yeah.
And so it was a little bit of a challenge for me.
Exactly.
It was a challenge for me constantly thinking about telling my business on social media. So he talked me into it, and we've been doing it weekly ever since. So I'm going to get started the way that we normally do, but I just want to kind of just fill you in a little bit about just, again, who I am, and because I don't know any of you, you know, for the most part, really. But that's okay, because you're going to get to know me because I'm not going anywhere, you guys. I am here. Okay. I am here, and I am here to stay. Wherever this man is, I am.
She's a long Kakalaki woman.
I am a long Kakalaki by way of AT alien. So just call me a mutt, okay? Again, I am Dr. Carmen Lee-Lalonde, and I am a naturopathic doctor. And just to make it simple, I am a holistic health practitioner by trade. That's what I do. And how this beautiful thing came to be was I'm a widow. And shortly after, about a year after, my husband passed away, and we were married over 20 years, and it was a phenomenal marriage. It was a very beautiful, beautiful thing, just what I wanted it to be, and we produced one son. And unexpectedly, he passed away, and it shattered me. So what I decided I was going to do, I was going to become the best widow ever. I had made up my mind that that area in my life had come to an end because God had taken it away if he did not want that to be. So I married my business. Okay? So my practice became my husband, it became my lover, it became everything. And I dove into my son and my puppy. And one day, one of my girlfriends said, you know what, you really have to have a candidate. You have to have social media presence with your business. And I was like, oh man, that's so green. I don't know anything about that. But I had a Facebook page. I think most of you probably have one. And I may have posted maybe 6 times in a year. So that shows you how often I was on Facebook. Nothing about it. But I knew that it had to be tied to my business. So she showed me how to go in and set up my business Facebook page. Well, while we're in there, she's educating me on feeds and things of that nature. And we were going through some of my friends on there, and we came across a picture. So for some of you who were here a little bit earlier, I handed out a business card to you guys, okay? And if you'll look at the business card, the picture on the business card is the picture that I saw. And when I saw this picture, I was like, wow, that is so cool. Is that like a dad, or is he a mom, or what have you? And she said, well, why don't you just hit like on it? And I was like, well, why would I do that? You know, I don't know him. And remember, you guys, I was going to be the best widow ever, okay? So in my mind, I was still married. In my behavior, I was still married, although he had passed away. I was looking at it like he was just gone for a long time. I just wasn't going to see him, okay? So when she told me to hit like, my first thought was, what will my husband think if I'm sitting up here hitting like on some man's picture, okay?
What's wrong with it?
And so she told me, she said, please don't be mad. She said, but I have to tell you something. He's gone, and it's okay, and you're just going to hit like. Sure. And she was right. I got mad. Because how dare she say that to me, right? But I'm a realist. And she was right. And it was just to hit the word like, right? So I did. I hit like. Then she encouraged me to make a comment. Okay? So I made a little comment. Lo and behold, the very next day, he sends me an instant message replying to my like and my comment. I was stunned. Because what does one do, right? I called my girlfriend and I said, oh my God, he sent me a message. She said, what did he say? I said, he said, hi. I said, how in the world is he going to send me a hi? He doesn't know me. I'm supposed to be able to say hi if you aren't your friends, right? And she said, no, honey, anybody can say hi. Anybody can send you a message. And so I was like, what am I supposed to do? She said, well, you may want to say hi back. I said, well, okay, well, but if that can't work, I said, I'll just say hi. I'll say hello. That sounds a little bit more professional, right? Okay, so I said hello. He replied back with a hi. I was like, ooh, here we go. Hello. He said, hi again. I was like, hello. So I was quite comfortable with hi and hello. That was great for me. This went on for 2 days. Then, on the third day, he sent a message and he said, is it possible that we can do more than hi and hello? And if I gave you my phone number, would you call? He wanted me to call. So what does one do? Okay, so if I call, then I have to have that awkward conversation like, what's your favorite color? What do you like to do? What's your profession? All of that. I haven't had that conversation in over 20 years. That was clueless to me, okay? But I was like, okay, exhale, take a deep breath, it's okay. It's on the phone, it's safe, right? So I told him, yeah, I'll call you. And so I said, so when do you want me to call? And he said, well, how about now? Well, it happened to be 7 a.m. And I'm thinking, okay. So I call. And my professional self, hi, this is Carmen Lita from Facebook. How are you? And he said, I know who you are. And I was like, oh, okay. Okay, hi. Good morning. Yeah. He said, good morning. I'm like, were you busy? he's like, get ready for work. And I'm like, okay. You guys, this torture went on for like 5 minutes. And I was like, oh my God, is this what talking to people on the phones like nowadays? It's so I'm not interested because it was like watching paint dry. I was like, you know what? If you're busy, I'll talk to you some other time. He said, well, you know what? I am getting ready for work, so I'll just call you later. I was like, okay, bye. And when I hung up the phone, I was like, oh, he doesn't have to call back. It wasn't that serious. It really isn't. It's okay. I'm good. And so I went on with my day. He kept his word, and he called back about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and it was a totally different conversation. He actually spoke. And he actually had something to say, but I told him how I felt about the first conversation, and he explained to me that he's not a morning person, he was rushing, and he maybe should have waited to have me call until later.
Right.
And so I said, okay, he gets a pay. So we talked, and you guys, it was awesome. He was so funny, he was so charming, he was smart, I didn't have to dumb down, you know, all of that, right? And so I was eager to talk to him again. And I give you this story because we are coming from two totally different backgrounds. I came from a marriage of over 20 years. I was not a heavy dater. I've always been in a serious relationship. So I didn't have a lot of dating, okay? So for me to be single parent, for the first time in my life, single for real and on my own, like for real as an adult, being a business owner, a homeowner, a woman, black, all these things kind of scared me. And I was like, Lord, what do you have for me? Because this is not me. What do I do in this new place you put me? And he told me to be still. I said, all right, I'm good, I'm obedient. I was still. But in my mind's eye, remember, I was going to be the best widow ever. So I thought that his language of being still meant to be still in this place and you'll be able to do things as an individual. And then he came. And we started talking, and it turned into just good conversation, and then it turned into more conversation, and then it was every day, and then it was throughout the day, and then it was 24 hours. And ladies and gentlemen, this happened in a matter of, 2 weeks? within 2 months, I had found myself falling in love with him. And that was strange, because when you have been in love with someone with whom you thought was your soulmate, to find yourself being gifted with the opportunity to find true love again, not once but twice. And I realized something in the third month, before I admitted to him that I was falling in love with him, that although I had, yes, married my soulmate, God rest his soul, but you guys, please know that God blessed me with my divine mate.
Wow.
All right. So I said, it's a good thing, baby, let me tell you. It's a real good thing. And so, like I said, I'm a realist, and I've been always been very open and very transparent, which is good for him, because if he knows where transparency is, his middle name. And so, he keeps it real. And so from March to September, we dated, and we were in different states. And all of a sudden, you guys, I had a boyfriend.
Yeah.
I had a boyfriend, but my boyfriend lived in North Carolina. And I lived in Atlanta, Georgia. And so one day, my boyfriend said, we need to get together and actually see each other.
Yeah.
And so, okay, 2 weeks after saying that, he came to Atlanta to see me. And you know how, like, how every superhero has their own, like, theme song? Okay. So, when he came and he got out of the car, and I got out of the car and I saw him physically for the first time, I heard Roberta Flack's First Time Ever I Saw Your Face. And you can see me running in slow motion, right? Because I'm running to him. He's standing there. I'm the one running. Oh, yeah, okay, I'll get you down. I'm running to him, and he gave me the best hug ever. And when he held me, I knew that was my man. But prior, he just reminded me, can you guys see this ring? Please see the ring.
Yes.
The ring. There's something behind the ring you gotta know. While we were dating, about after that third month or so, when I was falling in love with him, he said to me, well, he said, I was out today and I saw something that reminded me of you. And I said, well, what is it? He said, it's a ring. I'm like, ooh, I want to know about that. And so he said, well, you know, I'm going to send you a picture of it so that you can just see if you like it. And I'm thinking, this is kind of fast. And so he sends me a picture of this ring, and my mouth dropped for more reasons than you'll ever know. You see, it's an amethyst. And what he didn't know is that, like Valene, my birthday is in February, the 28th. The 28th, 28?
Yes.
Girl, yes, right? That's right. So my birthstone is amethyst. Okay, it's also my favorite color by default. The name of my business is Murasaki, which is Japanese for amethyst.
Wow.
Amethyst is the most healing quartz on the planet. Just to be in its presence, healing begins. That's why I named my business after it. He did not know any of this when he picked this ring out. So when I saw it, I was like, oh my goodness, you know, keep my mind, I'm obedient, and God said, be still. And I'm looking, and I'm like, oh, I want that thing. I didn't want to be that girl, you know what I mean? I didn't want to be that girl, right? So he said, well, do you want it? And I said, no, that's okay. No, you don't have to do that. That's really okay. Thank you so much, though. It's so sweet of you. And he said, listen, do you want the ring or not? And I was like, yeah, I want it. I want it. So he held the ring hostage until we got together. He didn't want to send it to me. Our commitment was when we got together for the first time, I would get my ring. So fast forwarding to when my theme song came on, and I'm running to him, and we see each other. He gives me this phenomenal hug. When we get in the car and we get ready to leave, he stops me immediately. He says, hold on. He reaches in his pocket, pulls out the ring box, y'all, all the stuff out of my skin. I saw my ring. And he puts put it on me, and I drove like this all the way back to the house because I couldn't stop staring at it. And it just, I love it. I love it because it set the tone at the very beginning of our relationship, and I will wear it always and forever. It means everything to me. And so I told the beginning, I told my part, so baby, I'm gonna let you tell yours because they know how I met you and they know what the experience was for me. Now you can share with them on your part.
Well, everybody knows that some people call me the church playboy. I've been in church and dating and all these kinds of things all my life. But I've been in search of the right woman, and it hasn't been easy. I've kicked a lot of them to the curb, and a lot of them kicked me to the curb. But I knew, a lot of my friends said, man, said, every time I turn around, you're with a different woman. But there was something down on the inside that just said, this is not it. And I mean, there were some beautiful women from all over the country. I mean, they were flying in from California. I had them flying in from Atlanta. They were flying in from everywhere, so I could meet them. But it's just something on the inside just wouldn't let me marry those women. And so after I met her, I just knew that she was the one. Right? So what else I need to tell you? She's a storyteller. She knows everything.
Well, you did. You knew I was the one, but you had some convincing.
Oh yeah. Let me tell you something. After God sent me this woman, I almost lost her. And how I almost lost her was that all those women that I was talking to before I met her, I was still talking to them. I mean, I wasn't getting up with them, but I mean, I was talking to them. And, once you get on social media, it's hard to get off of it. It's almost like an addiction. I mean, you can meet the most fabulous woman in the world, the most fabulous man in the world, but it's like an addiction because you're used to doing it. And so I almost lost her because I was still talking to women, she didn't know that, and then I was still talking. And so one night, she called me, and she said, what are you doing? And we had this conversation, and I said, well, I'm just sitting here chilling. And I said, well, listen, I gotta go. But what I was actually doing, I was talking to another woman, and I had to get her off the phone. We're just being honest, being straight, keep it real. And so she knew that something was wrong. She said, that's not like him getting me off the phone. But I was trying to get this other woman while I had this precious woman. Can y'all do that? We can do some dumb stuff, can't we?
You gotta give him the juicy, baby. You gotta give him the details.
And so a lot of time it takes us as men to come around longer than it takes women. Women, when they say they care about you, they love you, in most cases that's true. But we as men, we can play a game. We can play the game a lot longer and a lot smarter. So we think.
Tell them the details.
Well, I'm going to tell you the details.
Because you know I know the details, right? Because if we're all wrong, right? This is adults, right? So we're going to keep it real, okay? All right, because I know that there is nothing new under the sun, all right? And so if you haven't experienced it, you know somebody who has, and you probably will at some point. Okay, that's just keeping it real, right? All right, so it was Thanksgiving Eve. Be specific. And I am cooking and I'm trying to show him. I'm videotaping so he can see me cooking my turkey, cooking my foods. I was upset because I couldn't be there with him on our first Thanksgiving. And all of a sudden, you guys, Ren gets a headache. Now, poor baby. And Ren prides himself. You know Ren personally. You know he really prides himself on his health. Okay? So for him to say that he has a headache, which is rare, So I was like, wow, what are we going to do about this? Heck, you know, I'm going in to fix it mode, right? So I'm telling him what he can say, you know, give me some symptoms, what's going on with you, call your roommate, tell him you don't feel good, I'll tell him to just go get to the store. You know, I'm going to take care of him from a distance, from afar. But he kept, he was like, oh, no, I think I'm just going to lay down. I think I'm just going to lay down. And I'm like, well, no, I'm going to find out what's wrong with you, and we're going to fix it. That's what we're going to do. We're going to fix it. And so, earlier in the week, Ren was getting calls about seeing Telegram. And he's getting a lot of messages about him. And he asked me, he said, hey, can you do me a favor? Can you go into my Facebook and return some of these messages? He gave me his password.
Okay,
he gave me the password.
So, man, make sure you give a woman your password, you're straight.
Okay.
So, I don't know what you're doing.
Please hear me when I tell you where we're going, right? So, that was earlier in the week. So, every day, I was going into his Facebook page returning messages for testing and telegrams. Now, y'all, I was a good girl. That's literally all I was doing. Okay, I didn't search or snoop. I didn't do any of that. And so I'm sitting here trying to figure out what to do about this headache he has. And I had been in his Facebook earlier, and I left my computer up and it's just sitting. So I sit down in front of the computer to talk to him. And as I'm talking to him, I hear a boop. And I'm like, looking around, like, what's that? And I looked at the screen, and the message box popped up. And I'm looking at it like, that's weird. I mean, I'm not even on Facebook. I was thinking about myself personally. And then I forgot that I was logged into his site. Okay, so let me tell you how fabulous Facebook is. Ren is holding his phone, talking to me on speaker. But at the same time, he is texting or on Messenger, having a conversation with someone else. But guess what's fabulous about Facebook? I could see the message too. Because I was logged into his Facebook. So I'm looking at the message right there in front of me. Right in front of me, I see typing starting to go. I'm not typing. I'm seeing words form. And I'm like, what's this now? Ladies, I'm not gullible, right? So I'm like, baby, you okay? How you feeling now? Okay, sweetie, I know, babe. And I am reading the message. Let me just tell you what it was. Ren 1010 was planning a rendezvous for a quick little pre-Thanksgiving getaway. Okay. So as the heat is going to the back of my neck and rage is going through me, I'm reading it, but I'm listening to him tell me how bad he feels. He just feels so bad, poor baby. So when I saw what they was planning to do to one another.
Oh my God.
I had to get all the cobwebs out before I got with him, you know.
There you go.
Oh,
as he was planning on sowing his royal oats, I had to make a decision. Was I going to do the typical thing that you thought that I would do is just go off, right? Cuss and fuss and hoop and holler, right? I decided I was going to, I'm a smarter girl than that. I said, okay, I got this. He's not getting off the phone with me. Period. There's no way I'm going to let my man sneak off to a rendezvous with anybody. And I know it's happening. Oh, no, ma'am. Oh, no, no. And see, I knew what was better than him and what he knew, and I knew that he was better than that. So therefore, I had to get control of that without him knowing. So I told him, I said, baby, I'm so worried about you, I'm not hanging up, period. I said, so you're going to have to fall asleep with me on the phone and do not hang up. And he said, what? How selfish of you.
How can you believe how inconsiderate you're being right now? You know I don't feel good. You know I'm tired.